But I want you to kind of introduce yourself and kind of share how your journey and being a cardiologist and how you went from, I guess, conventional medicine, if you will, to what you're doing today.
You know, Crystal, for many years, I did, as you say, practice conventional, what's called interventional cardiology. That's where the situation where you open people's arteries and they're having heart attacks or having angina, you put in stents, you take drilling devices, open people's arteries, those kinds of things. But my mom died of sudden cardiac death a few months after her successful coronary angioplasty. She was living in New Jersey. I just moved to Milwaukee to set up all these new procedures in these hospitals. They wanted my an insight into technology. Well, it was a vivid illustration, Crystal, of how inadequate it was to try to manage a dangerous disease like coronary disease in a cath in a hospital laboratory, because things happen at home or en route. People die en route to the hospital. So just managing it, opening art, is not the right way. So I started looking for other ways to deal with this disease, and that led me to starting something called Milwaukee Heart Scan. It's just a device that quantifies the amount of plaque you have in your arteries, and they can predict your heart attack 5 years in the future, 10 years. It's a crystal ball, Crystal. So, but back then, all we had to stop it. So if you do nothing, you're given a score when you have a CT heart scan. You're given a coronary calcium score. So let's say your score is 400, which is a very bad score. Normal is zero, no plaque. Well, if you did nothing, not smart, but if you did nothing, that score of 400 a year later is about 500. Another year later, 625. About 25% per year increase if you do nothing. And of course, you, with each increase, you're closer to dying, having a heart attack, needing bypass surgery, those kinds of things. Well, back then, all we had was baby aspirin, statin cholesterol drugs like Lipitor, low-fat diet, exercise. So we helped publish these data. If you do that, the score goes up 25% per year. Crystal has no impact at all on that progression of plaque growth. And so people are freaking out on me. Thousands of people. It's one of the few scanners in the Midwest, one of the few scanners back then, 30-some years ago, in the entire country. And people, so the rules hadn't yet been developed. So I had to find out ways to put a stop to this scary and relentless increase in coronary atherosclerotic plaque. But it led me down a whole bunch of new paths, like appreciating the huge impact of vitamin D. I rejected this idea that reducing cholesterol was the solution. That should have been rejected decades ago, Crystal, but it persists because it makes so much money for the pharmaceutical industry. But if you do the more advanced testing to identify causes of heart disease, like NMR, lipoprotein testing, nuclear magnetic resonance, you take your clear part of your plasma, your blood, and put it in a magnetic field. You can quantify and characterize the particles in your blood. Well, you'll learn very quickly. This has been borne out now by dozens of studies. The major driver of coronary disease is not LDL cholesterol, which is a crude, indirect way to guesstimate the particles in your bloodstream. You can actually measure the particles, and you'll see that small LDL particles are the principal driver of cardiovascular risk. And you also learn that coronary disease, heart attack, etc., is completely manageable with diet. You do not need drugs to control all the factors that lead to heart disease. So the real tragedy of this nonsense about saturated fat, LDL cholesterol, and statin drugs is it took everybody's attention away from the real causes of heart disease. The real causes are easy to identify, and they're very easy to manage, so much so that every day we see people reversing their coronary disease, dropping their coronary calcium score, say from 700 to 340. And when you do that, by the way, your risk for cardiac events, like sudden cardiac death and heart attack, is virtually zero. It's easy to do, and it does not require medication. It just requires some nutritional strategies. That's the reason, that's the blessing, Crystal, and the curse. Because if the solution is nutritional, it means nobody can make a ton of money doing it. Mm-hmm. And so we do it. It works. It works wonderfully well. But it led me down a whole bunch of different paths and uncovering new ideas.
Okay. Okay. Now, you mentioned a lot in that I have a lot of questions about. Because, for example, the coronary calcium score or that test, I was just sharing that with someone maybe a couple of months ago, and they had never heard of it. Why aren't doctors, a lot of people aren't getting that test. How do people get it? How do people ask their doctors for it? What can they do?
So it's a wonderful test. I've been doing it for over 30 years. But the problem is my colleagues tend not to be interested in something unless it makes a lot of money. And so you can get a scan for about $100 now, $150, something like that. Most hospitals that have what's called a multi-detector CT scanner can do it for you. They don't advertise it because the only way they want you to do it is if you have a high score, then they get to scare the heck out of you. They say, Crystal, you have a high score of 500. You may not be safe. You're a walking time bomb. And they persuade you that high score obliges you to go through a heart catheterization, stent implantation, and other procedures that generate tens of thousands of dollars, even though you don't need it. In other words, if you have a coronary calcium score that's positive, above zero, and yet you're going to work, you're riding your bike, you're going for a walk, you have no symptoms. This is not somebody in an emergency room having chest pain or can't breathe. This is you and me going about a business. You cannot justify. There is no justification for putting you through hospital procedures. Yet it's done every day, Crystal. It's done every day because the payoff is so good. So what I reject that. I think that's disgusting. So I set myself the job of finding ways to put a stop to that coronary calcium score and drop it. Now, people say, well, it's a measure of hard plaque. We don't care about hard plaque. We care about soft plaque because soft plaque ruptures like a little volcano. Well, that's not true. Coronary calcium score is an index of total plaque, hard and soft and other things. And so it's a useful index. And so the risk of heart attack at a score of zero is essentially zero. I say essentially because I can't stop you from doing things like take methamphetamine, you know, things like that cause heart attack. But for all practical purposes, score of zero or low scores mean your risk for heart attack, death, et cetera, is extremely low, virtually zero.
Okay. Now, you also mentioned cholesterol, and that's often, I mean, I get confused by it. Everybody I know gets confused by it. People get nervous because they say, oh my God, I have high cholesterol. My doctor wants to put me on a statin. What should people, I imagine we need to be going a little deeper before we make that decision to get on a statin. What are questions people should be asking their providers?
I tell them to get a thick black magic marker and cross out total cholesterol and LDL cholesterol. They are meaningless numbers. They got their start about 60 years ago at the National Institutes of Health, NIH, Dr. William Fredrickson and William Friedewald. And they were looking at, they want a way to count or characterize the particles in the blood, the lipoproteins, fat-carrying proteins that lead to heart disease. So fats in the blood can't float freely. So it's like salad dressing. If you have vinegar and oil, the oil goes to the top. It's low density and it coalesces. Even if you shake it, you'll see the oil eventually separate, coalesces. Well, fat in your bloodstream does the same thing. If there's free-floating fat in your blood, it will coalesce and will cause death of your organs. It would infarct your organs, we say. So fats can't float freely in the bloodstream. They must reside. They must ride on a protein particle to make them water-soluble because blood is a water-soluble liquid. So those are lipoproteins, fat-carrying proteins. Well, those two researchers at the NIH in the 1950s and 60s, Crystal, wanted a way to count the particles in the blood. Well, how do you do that in 1959? Right? You can't. Mm-hmm. So they said this, let's choose one component of these particles. And it could have been apoprotein B. It could have been apoprotein C3. It could have been triglycerides. They chose cholesterol as a way to guesstimate the number of particles in the various fractions of blood. And by fractions, I mean they spin blood down and it layers out high density at the bottom, just like water and vinegar and oil, low density at the top and various grades in between. Sorry. But how do you count the particles in those layers? Well, you really can't, certainly not in that age. So they said, we're going to measure the cholesterol in each fraction. We're going to measure the cholesterol in the total fraction, total cholesterol. We're going to measure the cholesterol in the high density fraction at the bottom. We're going to measure the cholesterol in the very low density fraction at the top. Well, how are we going to measure it in the low density fraction in the middle? Not so easy. So they developed a very crude calculation. It's called the Friedewald equation, to calculate the amount of cholesterol in the low density fraction. Now, to do so, they knew. These weren't stupid. These were smart people. They said, this is very crude, but it gives you an easy method of guesstimating LDL cholesterol and thereby indirectly the number of LDL particles. And so they calculated this value. They knew that it was flawed. There are basic assumptions. They assume everybody eats the same diet. They assume everybody has favorable triglycerides. They assume nobody's pre-diabetic or diabetic. In other words, these are not true. And if you change your diet, it invalidates the equation. But that has become the prevailing standard for guesstimating cardiovascular risk. We know, Crystal, that LDL cholesterol is deeply flawed. How about this? What's the average LDL cholesterol of somebody who dies of a heart attack? 133. What's the average LDL cholesterol of a person who doesn't die of a heart attack, just everyday people? 133. I don't know about you. I can't tell the difference. It's a garbage measure. But it's persisted and become the standard of care because it makes a lot of money for the pharmaceutical industry. But as I said earlier, the real tragedy of this nonsense called cholesterol is that it took everybody's attention away from the real causes that are easy to identify and easy and free to control. But remember, so your hospital probably added the $75 million wing for cardiovascular care because to this day, despite over 80 million Americans taking statin cholesterol drugs, heart disease remains the number one moneymaker for hospitals. And so why would you kill the goose that lays the golden egg? So there is this quiet indifference to preventing heart disease.
So should people be looking at their triglycerides or their HDL, for example?
So in the four measures on a conventional lipid panel, total cholesterol, LDL cholesterol, HDL cholesterol, and triglycerides, the two numbers most neglected, triglycerides and HDL, are the two most helpful.
Okay.
So triglycerides, the reason for that is, so if I eat, let's say, wheat or grains or sugar, wheat or grains have the very dangerous carbohydrate called amylopectin A. So if I eat wheat, grains, or sugars, our livers are very good at converting those sugars to triglycerides. That's called de novo lipogenesis, the creation of fats out of the blue from carbohydrates. Now, we can measure as triglycerides, but they're really not occurring as triglycerides because triglycerides are fat and fat can't float freely in your bloodstream. They're actually occurring as very low density lipoproteins. Lipoproteins that are very triglyceride rich and very fatty. So we eat wheat, grains, and sugars, and the liver converts those carbohydrates to triglyceride, but really as VLDL particles, very low density lipoproteins that are triglyceride rich. Those VLDL particles, one, cause heart disease and interact with LDL particles, not LDL cholesterol, LDL, the actual particles, and make them small. And small LDL particles are very dangerous because they're adherent to the arterial wall. They're smaller, able to better penetrate the arterial wall. They're more prone to oxidation. They're more likely to cause inflammation in the arteries. And they last 5 to 7 days in the bloodstream as compared to 24 hours of large LDL particles caused by fat consumption. So if I have a slice of pizza on Monday, I still have small LDL particles by the weekend. So small LDL particles are extravagant, over-the-top cause for coronary disease. We now have 55 clinical trials proving it. That is, small LDL particles is the driver of cardiovascular risk. Eradicating small LDL particles reduces, and in many cases, eradicates risk. Not LDL cholesterol. Now, those statin drugs do reduce small LDL somewhat, but they're not specific for small LDL. They're kind of shotguns for all LDL particles. And once you see an NMR lipoprotein test, it's very easy. Insurance covers it. It's inexpensive, but it's more complicated. And there's no drug for it. So there's no sexy sales rep in your waiting room selling it to you with promises of dinner and a free week in Orlando. So there's no one pushing this kind of stuff. But if people come to understand this, you're given the ticket to extravagant, magnificent risk reduction of cardiovascular risk.
Okay. Now, one more question, because I have so many questions. Now, you mentioned the NMR test. I'm assuming that's different. I've heard of, I don't know what it's called, pardon me, where they, I guess it's a calculation or a measurement of the ApoB, ApoA. That's a different test, correct?
Yeah, sadly, there seems to be a popular discussion about how apoprotein B is superior. That's nonsense.
Okay.
That's coming from people who don't understand how heart disease is caused. So here, example, I say, Crystal, your apoprotein, so apoprotein B is the particle on every LDL particle. So apoprotein B is a virtual count of LDL particles. So I say, Crystal, your apoprotein B is 150 milligrams. What does that tell you about how you got that value, how you got it nutritionally or other factors? It tells you nothing, nothing. What if I told you instead, we're going to do a lipoprotein analysis, in this case, NMR. There are other ways to do lipoprotein analyses, but they've kind of fallen by the wayside over the last 30 years. There's electrophoresis, there's centrifugation, other methods. But NMR has kind of proven to be the gold standard, that is looking at your lipoproteins, your plasma, clear part of your blood, in a magnetic field. Well, what if I said this instead? Crystal, your LDL particle number is 2,000. Nanomoles per liter, particle count per volume. And of that 2,000, 1,500 is small LDL. What does that tell you? It tells you that you've been eating excessive quantities of carbohydrates, like the amylopectin A of wheat and grains and sugars. It tells you that you have insulin resistance. It tells you that you have inflammation. It tells you that you have an excess of VLDL particles from liver de novo lipogenesis. It tells me that you have a high C-reactive protein, measure of inflammation. It tells me that you have low HDL and your HDL particles are small and ineffective. In other words, just knowing your small LDL number tells you a whole bunch of this cluster of abnormalities that lead to heart disease. Would that apoprotein B of 150 tell you? Nothing. And so that's the comment from people. I know it's become a popular topic. You know what? I'm glad. It's starting to highlight just how lousy a measure LDL cholesterol is. But why trade one lousy measure for another lousy measure? Why not go to the real measures that tell you how and why you got here and how you can eradicate them? So by the way, so let's say your number was 1,500 nanomoles per liter, small LDL out of 2,000 total. You go wheat and grain, sugar-free. You take nutrients that synergize to minimize insulin resistance, vitamin D, omega-3 fatty acids, fish oil, magnesium, because we drink filtered water that removes magnesium, and iodine. And then we address some microbiome issues, gastrointestinal microbiome. And your small LDL goes from 1,500 nanomoles per liter to zero. It's easy. It's easy as heck. And you have essentially eradicated cardiovascular risk, no drugs required. Well, who's going to be selling it then? You know, there's not going to be a sales rep in a three-piece suit or a miniskirt to tell you that they're not going to do that. And so when the solution is easy, accessible, and essentially free, there's no incentive to tell you.
Right. Now, you mentioned vitamin D, and I want to touch on this a little more because I know so many people are deficient. At what time I was deficient, I just didn't know. My doctor wasn't testing. So it's fascinating how this can play a role. Can you elaborate more on that?
Yeah. So part of, so vitamin D, one of the major, first time, Crystal, the first time I saw a coronary calcium score drop dramatically, it was something like 700, dropped to like 350, something like that. I said, no way, come on. So I pull up the scans before and after, and you could see that the calcium had shrunk. And people say, you can only see calcium. No, you can see the soft plaque as well. You may not see it as clearly, but you can see the soft plaque. You could see that the soft plaque had shrunk, had regressed dramatically. And so, but the only time I started seeing that was when I added vitamin D. So vitamin D, a massive facilitator of regression of coronary atherosclerosis. There are other things. Like a big player nowadays is what's called endotoxemia. And all that means is, so we're supposed to have microbes in our colon, the large bowel. We're not supposed to have many microbes in our small intestine, the 24 feet of small intestine. But modern overexposure to antibiotics, glyphosate, the ingredient in Roundup herbicide, other herbicides, pesticides, chlorinated drinking water, stomach acid blocking drugs, anti-inflammatory drugs, preservatives like potassium sorbate, emulsifying agents like carrageenan and polysorbate 80, all the crazy stuff that you and I and your listeners are exposed to have disrupted the gastrointestinal microbiome. Among the effects, loss of many beneficial species, which allowed fecal microbes. These are species like E. coli, Salmonella, Campylobacter, which may sound familiar because they're also the causes of food poisoning. When you go to the fast food restaurant and a kid flipping your burgers, for instance, didn't wash his hands after moving his bowels and fecally contaminates your food. So we do not tolerate fecal microbes in anywhere but the colon. Well, modern people, because we've lost many beneficial species, have allowed fecal microbes to ascend into the entire 24 feet of small intestine. Well, the small intestine is very permeable by design, because that's where we absorb vitamins and minerals and amino acids, etc. Well, when fecal microbes come to colonize the small intestine, they live and die very rapidly, Crystal. They live only for a few hours. So trillions of microbes living and dying rapidly. When they die, they release some of their toxic components. One is called lipopolysaccharide endotoxin. And that, we say LPS endotoxin, enters the bloodstream. That's called endotoxemia. This, by my estimation, half the population in the country has this. It's called small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. We say SIBO, S-I-B-O. Mm. Now, you might not recognize it. You might recognize it as acid reflux or rosacea or psoriasis or obesity or abdominal fat, or type 2 diabetes, or Parkinson's disease, or Alzheimer's disease, or fibromyalgia, or sleep apnea, or migraine headaches. In other words, but we now have a way to connect a disrupted gastrointestinal microbiome, especially if it invades the small intestine, with so many health problems. So if you have, say, fibromyalgia, we can give you anti-inflammatory drugs and prednisone and antidepressants. But if you don't address the microbiome that caused it, you'll never have complete success.
Wow. So what can people do? Because a lot of times people stop, like, I'll give you an example. In 2020, early 2020, I was diagnosed with Hashimoto's. I did not accept that there was, the endocrinologist basically told me there's nothing you can do. Bye-bye. Come back once a year. And when your thyroid burns out, we'll take it out. I personally would not accept that. And I started doing the work and researching, and I learned how what I was eating played a crucial role. A lot of people stop with just a diagnosis. How could people, if you have a rosacea, like you explained, what do people need to ask? What do people need to do to see? Maybe it is SIBO. How can they start investigating and learning?
So these are autoimmune conditions, right? Hashimoto's, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, all these things. Well, there's shared causes. One would be the gliadin protein of wheat and related proteins in other grains like the cecalin of rye, the hordein of barley, and the zein of corn. They're very closely related. And that is known to be a trigger for autoimmune diseases. The increase in intestinal permeability that occurs with consumption of that gliadin protein also contributes to risk for autoimmune diseases. A lack of vitamin D. So lack of vitamin D doesn't cause a condition like Hashimoto's, Crystal, but it allows it to happen if other factors initiate it. Mm-hmm. And then endotoxemia. So if you have Hashimoto's, it's virtually guaranteed that SIBO was part of the picture. And because the increase in intestinal permeability and the activation of the immune response against your thyroid or other organs. So the solution to not have Hashimoto's or rheumatoid arthritis is don't eat wheat or grains, despite what the government tells you. correct your vitamin D. Omega-3 fatty acids help a little bit, not a big factor, but they help a little bit, suppressing that immune response. And then address your dysbiosis or SIBO, which, by the way, has become very, very easy. So one thing to know about SIBO, so half the population. Why do I say, by the way, half the population has SIBO? Well, it's very easy. Let's go through the several dozen studies to ask this question. In condition blank, what proportion of people test positive for SIBO? And there are a variety of ways to test, but usually hydrogen gas in the breath, because microbes produce hydrogen gas, but we don't. So let's say in obesity, what proportion of people with obesity test positive? Well, of the 108, 110 million Americans who are obese, 50% test positive. That's about 55 million people right there. Mm. How about in irritable bowel syndrome? What proportion of people test positive? Well, it varies from studies, but about 31%, 29, 31%, so about a third. So that's about another 20 to 25 million people right there. How about fatty liver? Or how about how about type 2 diabetes? And add all these conditions up, and you'll easily exceed 100 million, more likely 150 million. It's everywhere. Of course, there's some overlap, obese type 2 diabetics with fatty liver. But if you go through all the health conditions there are, you'll see that there's it's not uncommon. It's very – and what really turned my head, though, what finally persuaded me was this thing here, was the AIR device, A-I-R-E. This is the original device. This is the more recent device. They're just breath tests. You blow into it. It registers 0 to 10 hydrogen gas and talks to your smartphone. And any rise of 4 units is positive. And when I had started talking about this, what shocked me, Crystal, was – so many people tested positive. I thought SIBO was this uncommon, rare thing. No, it's everywhere. But what do you do about it? Well, if you go to the doctor says, "Crystal, have you been talking to Dr. Google again? Or right. There's nothing wrong with you, or it's in your imagination, or we didn't see anything on your endoscopy and colon, so it's in your head, right?" So most doctors are not aware of these phenomena. The rare ones that are will hand you a prescription for an antibiotic called Xifaxan. Well, with no conversation about why you got it, how to prevent common recurrences. It's expensive, has side effects. It's an antibiotic. And it has a track record of about 55 to 60% success. It's not very good. So I asked this question. Now, wait a minute. So we got microbes in the small intestine causing this to happen. Because what this really is, Crystal, is a mapping device. It tells you where microbes are living. So I asked this question. What if you just went to the health food store and bought an off-the-shelf probiotic? Would your SIBO go away? No. It might reduce the bloating, diarrhea, temper, but it really doesn't do much. Commercial probiotics are a very disappointing class of supplements. They're going to get better, but the current crop are mostly disappointing. So taking a commercial probiotic doesn't do much. So what if we chose, though, microbes that are known to colonize the small intestine and are known to produce what are called bacteriocins? These are natural antibiotics effective in killing fecal microbes. So I chose 3, a strain of Lactobacillus reuteri, a strain of Lactobacillus gastrui. Both of those colonize the small intestine, produce bacteriocins. And a spore-forming microbe taken as a spore, like a seed, called Bacillus coagulans that germinates in the small intestine and also produces bacteriocins. Now, when you buy probiotics, they sell them to you at very low numbers because it's very expensive to make microbes. So what I did was we fermented as something that looks and smells like yogurt. It's not yogurt. You can't buy it in the store, but it looks and smells like yogurt. What we're doing is we're increasing the counts of microbes 100 or 1,000 fold. If we ferment all 3 together, you get about 300 billion. So they may sell it to you at 1 billion or 2 billion. We're going to get 300 billion per half cup serving, and we consume it for 4 weeks. And so far, Crystal, 90% of the people doing this using the AIR device test negative. Test positive at the start, test negative at the end, and have all kinds of benefits. So people will say things like this. I did this, we call it SIBO yogurt. I did the SIBO yogurt for 4 weeks. My bloating and gas is gone. And I finally broke my weight loss plateau. Or I was a type 2 diabetic before your programs. My hemoglobin A1C was 11.7%. I did your programs. It's now down to 6.1%. Still much better, but still too high. We want 5% or lower. I addressed my SIBO with your SIBO yogurt. Now it's 4.7%. Ideal. So in addition to normalization of breath hydrogen gas, we also saw some kind of significant health benefit.
Okay, great. So if folks are interested in the AIR device and the SIBO yogurt, they need to look to you and your program. Correct.
Yeah, I did. Okay. I did call the inventor of the air device, Dr. Angus Short in Dublin, Ireland, because he didn't know what he's a great guy. He's my friend now. But he didn't. He's an engineer. He's a PhD engineer. And he invented this device to help his wife, who had irritable bowel syndrome, who was put on a very stupid low FODMAPs diet, low fiber, low sugar diet. But he saw she'd get tripped up and get gas and blood. So he invents this device to tell her when she tripped up on her diet. They commercialized and start selling it a few years ago, 2018. I got a hold of it and I called him up. I said, Angus, this is a mapping device. He said, what? but now they've changed their instructions. But the full protocol on how to use it is in my Super Gut book. It's also in my blog, the several thousand posts on my blog, drdavesinfinitehealth.com. Awkward name, I know. But we show people how to do the test. Now, I don't want people to hear, though, you need this device to navigate sleep. You don't. It is helpful. One of the areas where it's really helpful is, let's say you had gas, bloating, diarrhea, and depression as your signs of SIBO, or maybe fat malabsorption, fat droplets in the toilet, because fecal microbes in the duodenum block the action of bile and pancreatic enzymes. And so you eradicate it with the SIBO yogurt, or you're feeling better. 6 months later, you have a panic attack. You say, oh, is this SIBO or not? Well, that's where that device can be helpful. Because when you have a recurrence of SIBO, the symptoms can be different. And the reason for that is maybe your original SIBO was dominated by species like E. coli, Salmonella, and Citrobacter. The recurrence maybe is dominated by Enterococcus and Streptococcus. Symptoms are different. So having the device can help you decide. But you don't have to have the device. There are situations where it's so high probability that you have SIBO, you can just and if the solution, Crystal, if the solution was remove your small bowel surgically, you should say, well, damn it, you better be confident that's true. But what if the solution is something that looks and smells like yogurt that you make in your kitchen?
Right.
Well, you don't have to be so confident. And I kind of regret calling it SIBO yogurt, because what we're really doing is replacing microbes that you lost, that you should have had from your mom at birth, but you lost because you took antibiotics 20 years ago, or your mom took antibiotics. So we've lost. So what we're really doing is restoring what I call keystone or foundational microbes. And so even though we use it for 4 weeks to get rid of SIBO, I encourage people to do it sporadically afterwards, two or three times a week, to keep it from recurring. That seems to be preventing recurrence.
Okay. Now I want to talk a little bit about like wheat, because you have the wheat belly series. And then you mentioned corn. That's my addiction. Okay. So should folks just generally stay away from the wheat? Or can you ever restore it? Can you like ever go back to it if you once you heal, or is it just good to stay away?
So it's important for everybody to know that modern wheat is high yield semi-dwarf wheat. It's about 18 inches tall. It's very thick stalk, has large seeds and large seed head, and it's completely biochemically different from traditional wheat. For instance, it's 42 chromosomes. You know, you have 46 chromosomes. I have 46 chromosomes. Your listeners all have 46 chromosomes. There's no 14 chromosome humans, right? But traditional wild wheat is a 14 chromosome plant. Modern wheat is a 42 chromosome plant. It's a very different thing. So what they created this thing essentially in a laboratory in the 1960s for noble purpose, Crystal. They did it to increase yield per acre to feed the hungry people in the world. And it worked. Increased yield per acre 4 to 8-fold. What they didn't understand was when you introduce these dramatic changes into the genetics of that plant, they inadvertently amplified the toxic effects on humans. The gliadin protein, for instance, in wheat, cecalin in rye, hordein in barley, zein in corn, are converted to opioids, 4 or 5 amino acid long opioid peptides that amplify appetite. They stimulate appetite. So wheat is an appetite stimulant. The gliadin protein causes autoimmune diseases like Hashimoto's thyroiditis, because you can measure high levels of anti-gliadin antibody in people with Hashimoto's. The amylopectin A is a sugar, a carbohydrate, that is worse than table sugar in its capacity to both cause rises in blood sugar and insulin resistance, and cause formation of small LDL particles. So the diet to cut your fat and cholesterol, eat more healthy whole grains, causes heart disease. So, and there's other components of wheat and grains. Wheat germ agglutinin. Sounds like gluten, but it's agglutinin, because agglutination is blood clotting. So wheat germ agglutinin is completely indigestible to humans. You eat it, it passes out in the toilet intact, but in its passage through the 30 feet of gastrointestinal tract, it's extremely toxic to the gastrointestinal lining. It denudes the absorptive villi, the hairs on your GI tract. There are phytates in grains that bind calcium, magnesium, iron, and zinc, and they make them unavailable for absorption. So you have a bagel or whole wheat toast, and it binds all the minerals, and you poop it out. And that's why the biggest problem there is iron deficiency anemia that affects females more than males for unclear reasons. And of course, it amplifies magnesium deficiency. We're all magnesium deficient at the start because we have to filter our drinking water. It doesn't run over rocks and streams anymore. We can't drink from there because it's tainted. It's got fertilizer. It's got a sewage and herbicides, et cetera. So we have to filter the water. Water filtration removes all magnesium. So the loss of magnesium in water, modern produce has very little magnesium in it anymore, and then amplified by phytates that bind magnesium and pass out. So magnesium deficiency, major problem, because that adds to hypertension, heart disease, migraine headaches, eclampsia, heart rhythm disorders, all kinds of things. So we replace magnesium. So what we're really doing is restoring factors that are largely absent or lacking in modern life. Almost everybody's lost rotary. We don't get magnesium. We're never meant to consume wheat or grains. That was a mistake made by humans, but it became very popular. And of course, the tragedy is advocated by the U.S. government and other agencies, even though it's inappropriate for human consumption. So there's no way to justify it. Now, let's ask this question. Well, that's true. A lot of the toxic effects of modern wheat and grains is due to the changes introduced. What happened to the first humans who consumed wild einkorn wheat, 14 chromosome wheat, in the Middle East, the Fertile Crescent, what is now Syria and Israel? So people were hungry. You know, there's war, famine, drought, all the things that make food fall in short supplies. They turned to seeds of grasses. That's what grains are. They found that they could isolate the seeds of einkorn wheat, dry it in the sun, grind it with a stone, and then add water, heat it in a stone bowl, and make porridge. That was the first way people consumed wheat. Well, what happened to those people who first consumed wild einkorn wheat, or maize and teosint in Central America, or millet in sub-Saharan Africa? What happened to those people? Well, remarkably, Crystal, before then, with no consumption of grains, there was almost no tooth decay. So of all teeth recovered, 1-3% showed evidence of tooth decay, abscess, misalignment, tooth loss. With the introduction of wild wheat and those other grains, 16-49% of all teeth showed decay or loss or abscess. Now, before consumption of grains, with almost no tooth decay, there was no toothbrush, there's no fluoridated toothpaste, there's no dental floss, there's no dentist, and there's almost no tooth decay. So tooth decay is largely a product of wheat and grain and sugar consumption. And that's why we have to go through extremes to maintain dental health. We floss, we use fluoridated toothpaste, but also explains why all through human history, with the consumption of grains, tooth loss was a major problem. Wouldn't be uncommon that people by age 20 had no teeth. It was very common. You can read these accounts. There's plenty of accounts of how people did not have teeth or lost a lot of teeth or struggled with abscess formation. And, you know, the number one cause for suicide in hunter-gatherer populations who have Western foods introduced to them, tooth abscess. That's the number one cause for suicide because they're not accustomed to the food we eat, like breads and pastas and cakes.
This is fascinating. And would this also be, because I've heard some studies or something that your oral health is tied to your cardiovascular health in some way.
Yes, that's an emerging area. But there's a new appreciation, Crystal, for this idea of translocation. That is, microbes in one place, like the mouth, can take up residence in another place. Sometimes it's good. For instance, there's a species called Lactobacillus crispatus that a woman can ingest orally, and it colonizes the vagina, where it's the dominant microbe in a healthy vagina. A third of the world's women have lost it, by the way. But a woman takes it orally, it colonizes the vagina, discourages infections, candida infections, etc., restores vaginal moisture, and then even more remarkably, takes up residence in the bladder and cuts back on urinary tract infections dramatically. Now, wait a minute. How can a woman take it orally, and how can it colonize the vagina and the blood? There's no connection. There's contiguity, nearness in the groin area, the perineum, but no one knows exactly. So translocation can be a good thing. It can also be a bad thing. There's a microbe in the mouth called Fusobacterium nucleatum that proliferates when you have bleeding gums or gingivitis or periodontitis, and then it enters the bloodstream and colonizes the colon, where it is virtually certain, the evidence is very good, that it is a major driver of colon cancer. How about Porphyromonas gingivalis, another oral microbe that proliferates when you have bad oral hygiene, and it colonizes the brain. And you can find a brains and people with dementia filled with Porphyromonas. Now, what's not one thing we have to get away from, though, is this idea. This all started with the age of antibiotics, starting with in 1928 with the discovery of penicillin. For every infection, there's a drug or an antibiotic. So when it comes to managing the microbiome, we have to get away from that kind of thinking, because more important than eradicating specific species is addressing the context, the environment. So the way to control these microbes is not kill it, because you don't have antibiotics specific for a single species. Antibiotics are indiscriminate. It's like an atom bomb. It kills everything. If I drop an atom bomb on a population, it kills children, women, men, professors, gas station workers. It kills everything. Same thing with antibiotics. It kills a lot of things. You can't be specific. So when we're managing the microbiome, we address the entire microbiome, and we bring back healthy species like Rotari gastrii and Bacillus coagulans. Or fermented foods, extremely important. What's really cool about fermented foods, Crystal, so if I eat kimchi or kefir or yogurt, not stuff in the store, stuff you make yourself, or fermented veggies, all those things, sauerkraut, fermented sauerkraut, they have microbes like Leuconostoc and Pediococcus. They don't take up residence in our GI tract, but they cultivate proliferation of healthy microbes. So that's how we address disruption of the microbiome. Not an antibiotic to kill things, but addressing the context, the environment of the microbiome.
Okay, great. Now, I got one quick question, because someone I was talking to a few weeks ago, we were having, I don't know if it was a debate, if that was fair, about wheat. And he just kept saying, well, I eat organic and I got it from Whole Foods, so that means it's okay. What's your thoughts, Dr. Davis?
So it makes no difference. So, okay, maybe it doesn't have pesticide and herbicide residues in it, but it still has the gliadin protein. That's an appetite stimulant and causes autoimmune diseases. It still has wheat germ agglutinin that binds all minerals like iron, zinc, and calcium. It still has, phytates that bind minerals. It still has that GI toxic effect from wheat germ agglutinin. It still has amylopectin A that sends your blood sugar through the roof and causes formation of small LDL particles and thereby heart disease. In other words, whether there's pesticide, herbicide residues, and it is not the issue. You can make it worse. Some farmers will spray glyphosate, for instance, on their wheat after harvest as a desiccant to dry it out. So now it has glyphosate, and glyphosate is an herbicide, of course, but it's also an antibiotic. But it's an antibiotic of the worst sort, because it kills off beneficial microbes and doesn't kill fecal microbes. So he's right in that organic is a little bit less harmful. But it's like saying low-tar cigarettes has less tar. I only smoke filtered low-tar cigarettes. Does that make cigarettes healthy now? No, of course not. So you just, by reducing one component, it doesn't eradicate all the other problems.
Okay, great. Now I want to, because I know I gotta be aware of your time and respect your time, but I have to ask you about the recent craze of Ozempic, Wegovy, all of these different drugs, and what your opinion is on those drugs for our overall health.
Crystal, it's a $10 billion a year mistake. The FDA should never have approved that awful class of drugs. Yet my colleagues are saying, oh, they're miraculous, they're breakthroughs, they're magical. Because what happens? So let's say you paid $12,000 for a year's worth of Wegovy, right, injections. So besides the nausea and other things, so you lose 40 pounds over a year. Of that 40 pounds, 10 pounds is muscle. We know this with confidence. It's fact. Well, think about 10 pounds of ground beef on your kitchen table. It's a lot of muscle to lose. Well, muscle is the principal determinant of your basal metabolic rate. That is, the rate at which you burn calories for the work of life. Breathing, digestion, making new proteins for skin and other organs. So 40 pounds lost, you're feeling great, you're thinner. You look 10, 20 years older, though, by the way, so-called Ozempic face. But 10 of those pounds are muscle. You stop the drug because few people can afford that forever and don't want the side effects forever. You stop the drug, you regain 32 to 34 pounds, almost all of which is fat. And now you have more fat than you had at the start. You're more prone to type 2 diabetes, coronary disease, cognitive impairment and dementia, and breast cancer. There's more diabetics and pre-diabetics after than there were before because of the loss of muscle and regain of fat. So what people are paying for is to damage their health. And yet my colleagues are endorsing these garbage class of drugs. So one of the things I've been doing, so we did a small clinical trial. So we do these yogurts, but ladies all say this to me. Okay, so we're going to restore lactobacillus reuteri, that lost micro. Almost everybody's lost it. What happens? There's increased empathy. So oxytocin effects, increase in love and empathy, in the intensity of affection for other people, acceptance of other people's opinions, generosity. So great emotional and social effects. And an increase in libido. Men experience 50% rise in testosterone. Ladies have a return of vaginal moisture and sensation. And there's a return of youthful muscle. Personally, when I did this, in my 60s, Crystal, I gained 13 pounds of muscle. And my strength increased by 50% in 3 weeks. I didn't like, how can this happen? But I've seen it happen over and over again. So restoration of Rotary has dramatic effects. Youth restoring effects, Crystal. Muscle, libido, right? Bone density, immune response is amplified. Brings back so many aspects of youthfulness. Where was I going with this?
We were talking about Wegovy and muscle loss.
Oh, yes. So here's speculation. We're looking for a research partner. We do our own research, but this would be a very expensive trial. So if you lose 10 pounds of muscle for the 40 pounds you lost or so with those drugs, what if you did some of the things we do, such as Rotary and other things that preserve muscle? So we did a small clinical trial, 25 ladies. We said, please don't change your diet. Please don't change your exercise program. Just take these capsules that contained lactobacillus reuteri, marine-sourced collagen peptides, hyaluronic acid, and the carotenoid astaxanthin. By the way, those are things lost in the modern diet. Collagen, hyaluronic acid are supposed to come from consumption of organ meats, like tongue and heart and intestines and stomach. But most modern people, because of the low-fat, low-cholesterol message, have abandoned consumption of organ meats. And astaxanthin is just a carotenoid, like beta-carotene and lutein, that comes from vegetables. But astaxanthin comes from salmon, shrimp, and lobster. It's the pink or orange coloring because it's the most potent carotenoid of all. But modern diets, where you get your food in fast food or ultra-processed foods, are absent carotenoids. So we're going to replace things absent. Collagen, hyaluronic acid from organs, astaxanthin from, in this case, from shellfish.
Okay.
We give these ladies these capsules, and it was a skin trial because the ladies in my audience all say, we don't care about the empathy. We don't care about generosity. We don't care about muscle. We just want better skin. And I thought, well, that. So we did a skin trial. We did something called high-resolution skin ultrasound. We measured the thickness of the dermal layer of skin. That's where skin health is determined, in the dermis. And we registered a 15% increase in dermal thickness over 90 days. compared to about 6 to 7% with collagen alone. So we doubled or more the benefits, and ladies were thrilled. They lost their crow's feet. They lost their smile lines. Many started have reductions in nasolabial fold and forehead wrinkles. Their skin was moister. But we also measured their waist circumference in this skin trial, and they lost dramatic waist circumference, an average of about 3 inches, as much as 8.5 inches, without losing weight. Well, how can you lose up to 8.5 inches off your waist without losing weight? Well, consistent with the animal evidence and our human evidence, restoration of muscle. So what if we did that in these people who take GLP-1 agonist drugs? Can we block the loss of muscle, thereby allowing that person to stop the drug and not regain fat? So we're looking for a research partner, but you don't need the research if somebody wants to do this. Get that formulation. It's high-dose lactobacillus reuteri. We use marine-source collagen only because we want to put it in a capsule. You can't take bovine collagen. The volume is so great, you can't put it in a capsule. That's why you have to use scoops. Mm-hmm. But marine-source collagen peptides. Hyaluronic, by the way, Crystal, hyaluronic acid that most ladies are familiar with. They say, oh, I know why. Don't tell me about hyaluronic acid. I put it on as a serum. I pay a lot of money for a serum. Well, I asked these ladies, so you put it around your eyes. What did it do for your neck skin or your thigh or your abdomen? Nothing. Taken orally, you get magnificent effects body-wide. You get an increase in dermal moisture. You get an further increase in dermal collagen because hyaluronic acid stimulates collagen production. You get an increase in joint health because the synovial fluid of your joints, the lubricating fluid, is hyaluronic acid. I believe you get arterial health because the glycocalyx that lines your arteries, the signaling molecules, is hyaluronic acid. You get vaginal moisture because the uterus, cervix, and vagina is largely hyaluronic acid. And it's a fiber. It's sourced from animal products like skin and brain and tongue, but it's a fiber. It's a very unique fiber that causes a bloom in beneficial species. These are species that produce butyric acid, and butyric acid acidifies the skin. Healthy skin is acidic, pH about 4.5. Unhealthy skin, in some with acne, rosacea, psoriasis, eczema, is less acidic, about 5.5. 4.5 to 5.5 is a tenfold difference because the pH scale is logarithmic. So when you take hyaluronic acid, it causes a bloom in butyric acid producing species like Acromantia and Faecalibacterium. That goes to the skin, acidifies the skin, reduces blemishes, reduces redness, makes it harder for any kind of rash to occur. And because it discourages Staphylococcus aureus, that plagues a lot of people with skin rashes, and encourages the beneficial microbe Staphylococcus epidermidis. So hyaluronic acid, this thing all ladies know about because they apply it topically, the real magic. You can still do it topically, but take it orally and you get these incredible effects.
Now, let me ask you this, because I'm hearing a lot of, well, I don't know if it's a lot. There are some doctors out there that are saying that they use these GLP-1 agonists, but if you monitor the patient and you make sure they're eating healthy and you make sure that they're lifting weights or doing strength training, that it's okay.
Is it? No, it's nonsense.
Okay.
It exposes their ignorance. Okay. So there's an interesting, not with GLP-1, just with diet. So all the GLP-1 agonists are not magical. All they do is decrease appetite. They make you indifferent to food. Calorie reduction, right? So it's just another variation on the same theme. We could call it move more, eat less. Mm-hmm. We could call it push the plate away. We could call it lap band or gastric bypass or a GLP-1 agonist. These are all variations on the same thing, reduce calories. And we know when you reduce calories, you lose muscle. That is well established. There was a recent NIH trial, for instance, National Institutes of Health, where people with BMIs of 50, or these are massively obese people, put on a low-calorie diet, and 2 hours a day, 6 days a week of strength training and aerobic exercise. So a heroic effort. They lost 126 pounds. Wow! 23 pounds of which was muscle. So typically, 25% of weight loss with calorie reduction is muscle. In this case, they blunted it to 17 to 18%, but it still reduced their metabolic rate dramatically. Mm-hmm. In order to maintain their weight, they'd have to consume 400 calories a day, starvation, because their metabolic rate dropped so profoundly. This has been proven over and over and over again. If you lose weight by cutting calories, regardless of the label, GLP-1 agonist, lap band, gastric bypass, move more, eat less, or any of the branded programs, or these new apps, they say, oh, Crystal, you're stress eating, right? Regardless, they all involve reduction in calories. They all involve reduction of muscle, thereby reduction of basal metabolic rate, and it guarantees that you regain the weight. Even worse, Crystal, when you lose weight by cutting calories in whatever form, there's a distortion of appetite hormones, such that even when you lose the weight and then regain it, you're hungrier now than you were at the start because you have higher levels of appetite hormones.
So how do we lose the weight if we don't reduce the calories?
So I tell people, never reduce calories. If you did it for a day or time-restricted eating, that's okay. But if you reduce calories for any extended period of time, you're going to booby trap yourself. So never reduce calories. Eat when you're hungry. Now, here's the great thing. You remove gliadin-derived opioid peptides that stimulate appetite. Your appetite drops. We never restrict fat. Eat bacon. When you have pork, eat the fat. Olive oil, more butter. Fat is satiating. It makes food taste better also. And you restore lactobacillus reuteri that provokes oxytocin from the brain. Oxytocin dramatically suppresses snacking, so-called hedonic eating. So what happens is no gliadin-derived opioid peptides. We don't restrict fat. Oxytocin suppressing snacking. You may eat breakfast. Let's say 2 eggs, some sausage. I like to make sure we get some fermented foods in every meal, by the way, and some prebiotic fibers that nourish microbes. It could be just some black beans in your omelet. It could be some onions. You probably won't be hungry till 3 p.m., 4 p.m., 5 p.m. Eat something. Hunger changes completely. So controlling diet is very easy. So we're going to eliminate wheat grains and sugars that cause abdominal fat accumulation and insulin resistance. We're going to address nutrient deficiencies common in modern people, vitamin D, omega-3 fatty acid, fish oil, magnesium, and iodine that, when put together, synergize to further reduce insulin resistance that causes weight gain. So we reduce that. Then we address colonic dysbiosis, SIBO, and endotoxin. Real easy, such as with the SIBO yogurt. And what you see when people do this is abdominal fat shrinks, followed by subcutaneous fat, fat below the skin, and you preserve or even increase muscle that increases your basal metabolic rate, and weight loss occurs faster. No deprivation, no cutting calories, no extreme exercise. You can exercise if you like it, but you don't have to. In other words, we're going to revert back to the way it was supposed to be all along. So if we went to, let's say, the jungles of Brazil to meet the Yanomami, or maybe the Maasai in Kenya, or the people living in the highlands of New Guinea, there's no obesity. They're all skinny, and they're all heavily muscled. So we're going to go back to that. A restoration of youthful muscle, increased basal metabolic rate, loss of abdominal visceral fat, and everything falls in place. Your blood sugar is normal. Your blood pressure is normal. You don't have ulcerative colitis. You don't have hemorrhoids. You don't have constipation or migraines or depression or anxiety or all the other conditions that, by the way, Crystal, anthropologists call the diseases of civilization.
Thank you so much, Dr. Davis. This was fabulous. Now, you have to share with the listeners, how could they find out more about you? I know you've got your books, but please share. Let the listeners know how they can learn more.
Well, the most recent book, Super Gut, has all these recipes in it. How to make the Rotary yogurt for youthfulness, how to make SIBO yogurt to eradicate SIBO, as well as other ways to ferment foods and other ideas on restoring health. So the goal here is help people become healthy, because you know this, Crystal. My colleagues are not doing their job. Right. They're too busy dispensing pharmaceuticals and procedures for profit and have lost sight of what they should be doing, which is helping nice people like your listeners become healthy again. Yeah. And you can't do that with a stinking prescription for Lipitor or Wegovy that does not restore health. You got to do it on your own. So the Super Gut book has this all laid out. My website drdavisinfinitehealth.com has several thousand blog posts. It's got several hundred thousand forum discussions. And we do a two-way Zoom once a week. And we talk about these kinds of things. People get tripped up and making the yogurt. It's really very easy. Because, oh, it didn't turn out right. What did I do wrong? And all those kinds of things.
Thank you so much, Dr. Davis. I am eternally grateful. This was fabulous. And I know the listeners are going to love this episode. Thank you so much.
Oh, that's great. Thank you, Crystal. Thanks for doing what you're doing, because what you're doing is so important.
It is. Thank you.